Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming to our 96th Learn Fast webinar, our 22nd of 2021. We've been busy putting these together since March of 2020, and they've become very valuable tools for a lot of people, and a sense of pride for AIM and myself putting these together and sharing all of this great information with the help of many, many, many good people that we've had as guests and co-hosts coming in and joining us. And as part of that is we've met a lot of people and had a great time doing these things, and not just from the here in North America where we are the distributors for the AIM products, but from all around the world. And of course, we've from our friends from Italy and our guest today from the Netherlands has been here with us since the very start. He's been at almost all, we'll let him talk about that a little bit more, but almost all of these live. And the ones that he's had to miss, he's certainly watched on YouTube later. And we've all got to know him very well in the chat box. And then we've been able to have some chats with him on Zoom off of this, and answered some questions, had him answer some questions for us. And it's been a great time. It's just part of this this family that we've built here with these webinars. And I thought it would be very, very cool to have one or two people that are with us a lot, and certainly have a lot to add to what we're doing here. And Tice has been the first one. And thank you very much, Tice, for coming. I know it's not what you signed up for when you first started watching these, exactly. But you've been a great guy to have around here and chat with, and watch you chat in the chat box while we're doing these. And I thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
We're gonna have a good time. We've done some neat things. But one of the things that we did was we were kind of chatting back and forth and asking Tice if he would join us what kind of stuff did we want to chat about. And I certainly do want to chat a little bit about the webinars and how they've affected him and what he's learned and what he shared and some other things, but I get to know him a little bit better. For those of you that have been watching, when you watch live, we have the chat box here going. Those of you that are in, pardon me, those of you that are watching this later on YouTube, you don't get to see that as much, but you'll see some of the questions and you'll hear us talking about the chat box occasionally. But I wanted to introduce everybody else to Tice a little bit more and find out some of the cool stuff that he's doing. And he's doing some very interesting things. So I'm going to bring up this first slide. Let's chat a little bit about Tice and what he's doing and who he is. And then he has shared a data file that we'll make available to everybody in the chat box and in YouTube later. Down in the description box, you'll have the data file that we're going to be going over, some cool user profiles and some information. We also are going to share his user profiles, that a subset of what he normally uses. We'll talk more about that as the hour goes by. The math channel file, the AMC file for Ray Studio 2, is shared. Will be a link for that in the chat box and in the description in the YouTube for later. And he's also built a track map, although we don't go deeply into some of the segments and how he does it, but he also shared that as well. So everything you're going to see on the screen today in our live data portion of this webinar, you'll be able to download. I see the links are already in the chat box. And again, if you're watching this later on YouTube, they'll be down in the description box. Download the data, the profiles, the math channels, and the track map, put it onto your own computer and watch along and work along as Tice explains some of the cool stuff that he does as a mechanic and a data guy. As I started to chat with Tice, the first thing is within about the first two or three, kind of a backstory, but within the first two or three webinars we did, Tice was joining us. And as an American, I see his first name and T-H-I-J-S, and that the TH sound here in English is made me, I couldn't say his name right. And so I wrote him a note, an email afterwards, and he helped me. It took a couple, two or three times for me to get the hang of it. And he finally explained to me how to say his name. So that was kind of a funny story as we got started. But then as we got to meet Tice a little bit more, a little bit of his backstory started to come out, and I'll just share a few things here. And then Tice can maybe fill in some of the gaps, but couple things. Awarded multiple times the best Skoda and Volkswagen mechanic of the Netherlands. That's where he's from, Assen, Netherlands. Awarded twice best Skoda mechanic of the world from the Skoda factory. That's pretty impressive stuff. Currently, as the picture down in the lower right, technical support engineer at a depot of the Dutch National Railways. So he's taking some of this information. It certainly transfers across motorsports to jobs and all different parts of life, and he's using some of the same technical thought process of that he uses at his job in his motorsports. So started racing in 2005 in the Netherlands Championships as a mechanic, Saker, I'm not too sure which, sports car. Saker sports car. Worked many years with teams, including some of the factory teams in the area as a mechanic and a data guy. And one of the interesting things that he shared with me, and we'll no doubt get into this a little bit more, is as he was getting into motorsports, he found the sample data files, the free Race Studio 2 software that we're going to use today. And he found that in the early 2000s, and it included in that is some sample data. And I put the Renault sample data, but he also looked at the sports cars from there. There was four files in there. There was a karting file, I think an open wheel file, the Renault file, and a Porsche from Daytona. And he did a lot of this learning on his own, just opened it up and started playing around. And I think that's pretty impressive. And also shows that he's been using this for quite some time. Again, thanks for joining us, Thijs. Give us a little bit more, maybe a little bit more meat on the bones from from what I added there, and tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Yes. No. Again, thank you for having me. I'm educated as a technical specialist in passenger vehicles, and I worked for over a decade at a Volkswagen dealership. And Volkswagen is a large brand with a lot of sub brands. So I've also worked at Skoda. I don't think you know it in the US. And also for the Spanish brand Seat. I worked that for over 10 years. And in Germany, it's quite common to have championships for championships inside of the brands for the best mechanic or the best after sales partner or the best body shop worker. And we had an inside joke at my job, and my boss told me, just sign up, you learn a lot from it, it's fun, and maybe you can go to the national finals. The best 10 of the country get to the national finals after some online courses. And well, by accident I went to the national finals and I won. Big shock. So, and when you win, you go to the international final also. Well, that didn't get really well the first year, but everybody said you have to defend your title. And of course, you will. Yeah. So I won again at Skoda, and I go again to the World Championship and I win.
So impressive, impressive.
Yes, and it's a championship of theoretical questions, some mechanical jobs like changing a timing belt, and also one or two electronical issues. So you have to measure things and really troubleshoot. I did that three times for Skoda, went twice for Volkswagen also. And yeah, it's amazing that I can say I was once the best of the world for Skoda.
There you go. Yeah. And you probably still are. So the even though you've changed jobs now and went into the trains, yeah, and the operate, what exactly are you doing when you're working for the Dutch National Railway?
I'm working there for 6 years almost now, and I'm the intermediate between our mechanics and our engineering department. My office is literally 10 meters from the workshop, what you see. And when mechanics have problems, questions, they come to us, and we will help. So we'll do complex troubleshooting, investigation of small safety incidents. We also write work instructions for the mechanics. And we are in support of engineering for questions, measurements on the trains, that kind of stuff.
Very important job that that I'm afraid a lot of companies do not put a lot of importance on. And boy, I'm glad to glad to hear you guys are doing that. That's pretty cool.
And I think it's pretty cool to mention that when I, since I work for the railways, I think every power output of a car is very little.
Yeah.
The trains that you see here are powered electrical on wind energy with 1,800 volts direct current.
Ooh.
And with 2,400 kilowatts of power. So, I think 500 horsepower is sweet now in a race car.
Yeah, it's nothing, right? Are those typically non-passenger trains, or are they
all passenger trains?
All passenger trains, okay.
We do only passenger trains.
Gotcha.
So, train sets of 150, 200 meters. And you can stuff 1,000, 1,500 people inside.
Wow, yeah.
So it's all large and heavy.
Important that it continues to move too, right?
Yes, yes.
Getting into your motorsport side, you, your first encounter with Race Studio 2, I mentioned that you found the software and you started to play with the tinker with the sample data, and give us maybe just a little bit more on that as before we jump into and start looking at some current stuff.
Well, I was from little boy always a big motorsport fan, and I always said I want to do the mechanic side of it since little. So. And then you start at school and you have some time off, and I found Race Studio and it intrigued me always, the data side. So I played around with Race Studio and didn't know much, of course, and just trial and error. And then in 05, I started with a team in the club segment of motor racing in the Netherlands. As a mechanic, and I worked for in 4 or 5 years for several small teams, also the factory team of Seiko sports cars, and did some mechanics work. We saw the first data sets coming in the cars. The MXLs came in with this work cars without a canvas connection to the logger, so we have not that many channels. But okay, it was good to check on oil pressure and RPM and some small driver inputs, throttle, RPM, speed, just one speed channel, no GPS. So I played a lot with it. Then I went in 2010, or the fall of, in the fall of 2009, I started in Formula Renault as a mechanic, in the bottom left. I've done that professionally beside my normal day job for 6-7 months. And the big plan was to do that full time, but it wasn't. All the traveling and the two jobs, and it wasn't for me. So I quit with motor racing for almost a decade after that. I had at the time more than enough of it. And but in September 19, a former teammate of me called me because they were at the racetrack in Essen. That's 10 minutes from my home. Man, we have a new team, and come get a cup of coffee. And within 5 minutes, my hands were dirty. Within 10 minutes, I had a laptop in my hands. And within 50 minutes, I was in love again. So I'm back. So it was a long time off, in 10 years, of almost 10 years. So all the knowledge was far at the background. And and the webinars helped a lot to get the gist of it and to improve a lot.
And that 10 years, clearly you were where you were focusing on your profession, getting very good at it. And the to the webinars, there's a couple things that I think, as you and I have chatted a little bit, you've met some new contacts, and you've got the chance to chat with people. And how has that been valuable to you?
Well, a lot. First of all, my English has improved a lot.
Yes,
I don't seem to hear it because of my accent, but You have to believe me, my accent of my English improved a lot, in, especially writing. And I have good fun with some people from the webinars, Matt especially. We have some fun in email about pitot tubes and and other stuff. So yeah, it's nice to learn from other people. And
and then the webinars themselves, as you've been watching the webinars, there's anything that really jumps out at you, some of the stuff that you found super valuable.
Yes, the math channels, I think.
Math channels.
And the biggest thing, the last time I worked with the RayStudio before the webinars, I only could get the gear channel in the math channels working. And I think I have in my current setup over 60. So I learned a lot, and especially the if statements are so powerful to use. It makes life a lot easier to see things.
Ray Phillips has worked with us on a couple of webinars. One of them was focused fully on the if statements inside of the math channels. So Ray's very, very, very smart that way. And I've gotten a lot of feedback from a lot of different people that was one of a very eye-opening webinar for a lot of people.
Yes, and also Emiliano's one with the or and and statements.
Yeah, exactly.
So plus and the asterisk symbol. Mm-hmm. That's really powerful to know. And
perfect. And then one of the things you've shared with me as we've chatted a little bit back and forth was that I use the term, you know, what happened, where did it happen, why did it happen, right? As a process of walking through. And you use the term a lot as we were kind of preparing for this, of peeling the onion, you know, starting at the outside and working your way down until you get a result. Give a little bit of we'll get some examples and some data here just about just a couple of minutes. But I always thought that was a pretty good way of getting people to focus on where we're heading.
Thank you. In my opinion, data starts before the session. First thing, so you know your track, you know your conditions, write them down because you need them afterwards. Get your setup sheets, get your tire pressures before the session. During the session, watch lap times, watch split times. It will paint a picture for you what's happening with the car. I also use feedback forms for the driver. So immediately after the session, I will talk, or the engineer will talk with the driver and write down some questions, what happened on the track. I have a very simple first question. Did you hit something or did you get off the track somewhere? Because it's the most important information to the mechanics. They can, when they get the car back from Parc Fermé or the scrutineering, first thing that they have to look is after the damage. And of course, there are more questions about grip and performance of the car and everything. And we score them with 0 to 10. And I keep track of that code that you get out of that questions and put them in the notes of the data file.
0 to 10, 0 being undrivable, really poor, 10 being perfect, really good. Yes. Is that how you do it?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
And that's the question. How was slow speed turning? Slow speed mid-corner, slow speed exit, and the same for high speed, for example.
And as a data guy, engineer, mechanic, doing these things, then the way that you use that, I suppose, is that drives you where you, the order that you're looking at the data that we're going to look at here in just a minute, right?
Yes, it has two reasons to do that. When you look at your data 6-7 months back, because you're going to the track again, you have, at least I don't have any idea what was then with the car happening. Mm-hmm. So that will paint a picture afterwards. And also it will give you any direction to go for to look for in the data.
And we'll jump. Let's jump into just bringing up the data right now, just so we'll have it here in front of us. And I'll open up the user profiles again for those of those of you watching now or watching later in YouTube, this data file is available for you. Tice has been nice enough to make this available, and it's from that that Audi that was on the opening slide that we started with. And so you can open up this data file. You can also download the user profiles. I'm going to click on that link right here. Here's a set of user profiles that we're going to get to in just a second. Also, there is a set of math channels that come along with it. And here are the math channels that we're going to be talking briefly about, specifically about some of them, but certainly using a lot of them in our presentation today. Those are available to you. And the track map. Tice has created a track map that he likes to use for this particular track. And while we're not going to talk about it specifically here at all today, I thought it might be good for everybody to have that as well. And that's downloadable as an MP file. So all four of those links have been in the chat box, and they'll be in the YouTube description below. So you talk about chatting with the drivers and getting everything kind of ready. Now you've downloaded the data video, if it's there as well. And you've got these profiles that you talked about early on. The data starts before the session starts, right? You've created a lot of work. You've worked with Jorge Seegers in the past. He's been a guest here. And one of the things I noticed from him, and I know he teaches in his, the way he does his work, plus the way he teaches in his seminars, is preparation. Preparation is really a big part of what we do. And that's what you've done here. So you've got this series of user profiles, and the first couple of them we're certainly going to look at always, it sounds like, and you can fill us in on that. And then the feedback you've gotten from the drivers then drives you where you're going to go look next, right? So give us a little bit of a feedback on the data file, what it's all kind of about. And then let's start walking through these user profiles. Some of them are really, really cool, the way that you have thought through to present the information and how you use it. And I think that's where we're going to spend the rest of our time here today. And I know a lot of people are going to get great value out of it. So what is the data file a little bit? And then we'll jump into where you go first.
This is a data file from the track in Zolder in Belgium. It's a track of 4,000 meters, a little bit start-stop with three chicanes and more or less a hairpin. It's a front-wheel drive car with it's a 2-liter turbo, so 350 horsepower, something like that. Mm-hmm. And this is the first day this driver drove the car.
Okay.
So you will see some errors in it.
Yeah.
It's fine. And I like to think of my user profiles as a toolbox. I have some user profiles I always use, and I have a lot of them when I only use when I have a problem. For example, this one is about oil pressure. I think we will use it later on in the webinar. I only look at it when I have an oil pressure issue. So I like to have things ready to use when I have issues.
Yeah, we've talked about a lot of the data analysis triangle, right? You've got driver performance, helping the driver get faster. You got vehicle performance, helping to make the vehicle, carry that speed. And then you've got vehicle health. And vehicle health, you and I have chatted a little bit. That's the first thing you look at after chatting with the drivers. You got to get... understand if there are any issues. It's the thing that takes the most time for the mechanics to fix and to find the parts. Yes. And repair the car, and you got to be out on the track in another hour. So you've got an engine report here that you say you jump to is the first one you jump. Yes. To. So I'm gonna go ahead and load that one.
It's always the first.
And it's just a channels report, right? Right off the bat.
Yes. We always speak of the money channel here is this, which is speed. Mm-hmm. Absolutely true, but I have two more money channels, mm-hmm. but they cost money when they're wrong. So
sadly.
I will stumble over them in a moment. So the first thing I do is scroll through this report, and it simply gives you all the car information there is. So, for example, RPM. That's our room. That's one of the money channels. This is the quite normal RPM band to use. But when you see 9,000, 10,000 RPM, you have to do a lead down test, I think. And it will cost money.
We need to peel more of the onion and figure out what in the world happened, right?
So, and especially when you're running with rental cars or paying the drivers, it's an important channel for the team boss to see. So important one.
And you've got min-max voltage. Again, just you're able to scan these very quickly and just and walk your way across and see if anything jumps out at you that you need to go investigate very, very quickly.
Yep. And I like to use the histogram button.
Oh, that's right. So let's grab one. Maybe the RPM might be a good one to show that. And that one fills it up for the most part, but it'll make some outlier really jump out at you, right?
Yes.
Yeah, minimum oil pressure. Yeah, there you go. You know, that 144 right away, my eye goes to that and you go, okay, well, what happened there? But it was kind of an in-lap, slow down laps, and maybe you got the RPM real low and there was lower oil pressure, something like that,
I guess.
Okay. Yeah. Who knows? We would need to dig in, obviously, but it certainly jumps it out at you. And then you,
the things I look at.
And you stuff a lot of them in here. There's I've turned off the measures and laps toolbar so we could see more of them, but of course you can scroll your way sideways. Well, let's just scroll all the way over to the end and see a little bit more of what you've put in there.
Well, the water temp, of course, is important to check min and max. Mm-hmm. You go check oil temp is important, of course. Inlet air temp is important because it's a turbocharged car, so this will say something about the state of the intercooler. Mm-hmm. Ambient temp is nice to have. Mm-hmm. This is the ABS. So this channel is more or less the indication light on the dash on a normal car. So when it's zero, it's fine. Is it one, then we have an ABS error.
Kyle asked a question that almost exactly where we were just chatting. Kyle asked, can you report like that flag if a code was set in the ECM? It kind of an interesting thing that you have done here. Number one, we would see a one here as a max code if the flag was flagged in the ECM. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to turn this into a secondary question that we've got this lap marker over here. And what have you done there that might be useful to some people?
Yes, this is a works car with an electronic steering wheel with a lot of buttons on it, and it's connected by CAN bus to the central computer of the car, and we have some buttons on the steering wheel that aren't used in the car. So I've mapped a MAF channel to one of the buttons on the steering wheel, so when the driver pushes that button, I get a one here. So I have a free lap marker button.
And that's pretty cool. So if the driver's out there and he feels a miss or he feels anything, right? It's his job just to go up and tag it. We'll see that he tagged at least somewhere in here, and then we can see what lap it was, open it up, and then go and see exactly where that tag was. And of course, that would trigger a discussion with the driver as well that you may have already had that discussion.
Exactly, because that question is also on my feedback form. Did you hit the lap marker and why? So I will be triggered from both sides. And to answer the question, no, I can't see the exact error code. You will see also a channel flag engine error. The one to the left.
Oop, right there, I'm sorry, right there.
Yeah, that's the status of the mail light, so the fault light of the engine. So this will trigger me to get another laptop to look in the ECU of the engine.
Go dig into the ECU itself, itself, figure that out. A couple things I want to add here. We are spending a little bit of extra time here because this is such an important part to what you do. This screen is the first place you go. We've talked about it here in our in some of our webinars in the past, and I thought I'd mention it again, and plus one other thing. Let me turn off the histograms. Wherever you have a little tip for those of you that are playing with these channel reports, the one of the cool things that is not documented well is if you've got a min or a max value all of these different values. If you have averages, of course, we can't do it. But if you're using mins and maxes, you can look at that 7167 RPM, and that's, you know, 400 or 500 RPM higher than everywhere else. You know, that lap had a little bit closer. One of the cool tools that you can have is the ability to click, double click on any of these min max values, that max voltage. Click on it and it will open up the measures graph. It'll open up that lap and it'll put the cursor right where that happened, whatever it is. What, you know, I'm going to go ahead and do it on the max RPM just to show you how it kind of works. But the it'll work on any min max value. It's kind of a cool little thing. So if I just double click on 7176, it's going to come up. He has his set up for multiple pages. So it's asking, okay, well, you want one. Since I didn't have one open, we just had the engine report open. What do you want as far as one of them? I'm just going to pick this one. I have no idea what it is. And it is just this. It put the cursor right to there. It opened up the correct lap. If we look, it opened up the lap that RPM happened at. And if I go to measures and turn on, now I got to find it, right? Turn on the RPM value, and then I'll just jump down. I'll just change it so we can see it. That's where the over rev happened. Kind of a cool tool that a lot of people don't know of in the channels report. So it always opens up the right lap and puts the cursor at the right place. It does not open the channel though that you're looking for. So if you know you clicked on the RPM engine channel, turn it on and you're going to, pardon me, you're going to have the cursor placed right where that happened. Kind of a really, really cool tool for those of you that to jump in really fast and see those things. And the second thing that I might add, if a channel report like this is important to you, and I think it is to almost everybody, the one of the cool things that I have started to do is I'll make an engine report, and I'll also have maybe broken up into several channel reports. So it doesn't get so wide that you have to go search real hard for it. I may do one with engine report oil, pressures, maybe one in engine report temps and miscellaneous. And then every time you come over here and click on a different one, you can have this report being even more specific to a certain area of the car. Just a thought, if you don't want to have this be so wide that you have to scroll a long way over to get stuff. So just a thought. Okay, perfect. So this is one of the first places you go. And again, just for those of you that maybe came in a little bit late or are watching this on YouTube, this data file, these user profiles are all available to you as links in the chat box now or in the description below, where you can look at this exact data and play around as we are doing it today. So after you do that, like you mentioned, you have different feedback from the drivers and the mechanics and everybody. I think we're just going to maybe go through these just really quickly, just one by one, but you might jump around at this point, but this is always kind of your home starting spot, right? Yes.
And I hadn't edited it in the user profiles because it's a simple graph with only speed. I will use it a lot to overlay laps to see difference and trends in it. So
okay,
that's an easy one to pick. And yeah, example driver input, number 6.
Number 6 might be the one. We'll jump into that one real quickly.
I will check with the driver and look for things. It's a little bit, it's quite full with data, but you'll have here all the inputs of the driver to the car.
So what is your, when you go to create a new user profile, what's your process? What you think about, the way that I do it, and maybe you can either say it's the same or slightly different. The way new user profiles come to me, since they're very personal, they're the way I like to look at data, right? So what I end up doing is I end up creating, I'm looking for things in the data and I'm finding some things. And so I've gone down some roads where I end up creating some graphs and the way the screen is laid out. And when I get there and I get the answer I'm after, and it ended up being a valuable tool, I go, okay, this would be a great user profile. I would like to use this in the future. So we come over and we build a new one. Is that the process you follow, or is it just as evenly, maybe you think up some ways even ahead of the being at the track?
sometimes, and in most of the cases, I think I want something for oil pressure, for example, and I collect all the channels I have that can influence oil pressure, and I will build something of it.
Let's load that one just so, and we'll use that as a kind of a discussion. Yeah. So here we've got, I'll walk through it really quickly, and then you maybe you can give us a little bit of background. Yeah. In the upper window here, you've got what we call the money channel, and it's just, we always have it on a graph. It just helps us understand the acceleration zones, the braking zones, the turns, that kind of stuff is the speed trace. You've also got your throttle position, so you know if the driver was hammering down and a good hot lap. And the second one, you've got RPM and engine oil pressure. And then you've done something pretty cool here where you've got a left and a right XY plot. And then of course the track map right in the middle so you can see it. So where do you get the most value out of this particular user profile?
This user profile I only use when I have an oil pressure issue. And I think with all the information in here, you already know what happens. Mm-hmm. And with this, you can easily see where it happens and maybe even why it happens. So at the bottom left, we have the lateral acceleration versus oil pressure.
Mm-hmm. So you've got your lateral G's across the X-axis, and you've got your oil pressure up and down the Y-axis, and you end up with this where you're going to find oil pressures if you've lost it, if it's been influenced by lateral, turning forces, exactly. Obviously. Okay. And over here on the right,
It's the G long, so it's the braking and the acceleration forces. Mm-hmm. Versus oil pressure again.
Perfect. And you've actually got that flipped, and maybe that's just to make it land the right way or whatever, but you've got oil pressure in the X-axis across the bottom and then the longitudinal. It makes more sense for me this way as well. I just wanted to point out that the oil pressure is across the bottom on this particular time. Yep. And then as you're kind of scanning this particular lap, here I'm just looking at the oil pressure. You can see there's a little bit of a drop right there, and there's a little bit of a drop, and we can see some low oil pressures, down in here and in here. Okay. So I'm going to put the cursor, right here on this little on this low oil pressure area. We can see right away there's the X. It's low oil pressure, and it's low oil pressure over here. It's happening at virtually no lateral G's, right? Okay. And it is happening though, however, at a large negative. Braking force, right?
So it's a large braking zone during downshifts. You see at the RPM. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to zoom in just a little bit to make it even clearer to see. And so here's your lack of oil pressure at the RPM is down a little bit, not super low, but it's not super low oil pressure either. No. It's still 2 bar, so it's not terrible. But boom, it jumps out.
Yeah. And I see Matt's comment in the chat. He's absolutely right, but I haven't had any chance to modify the setup of the data of the dash. So the z-axis was off, but I will edit, of course, as another graph, the z-axis, so the up and down movement of the car.
It's Matt, I will share with everybody here. It is kind of funny. We normally do a quick run through on Mondays before we do these webinars. And that was probably point number one or two that Tice mentioned to me, is he wanted to add the Z axis into this very user profile. So that's kind of funny that you mentioned that. So, okay, well, perfect. So you quickly scan it, maybe select select a different lap or whatever it happens to be, right? And boom, you get what you're after out of this one.
Yes, and I've plotted the oil pressure on the GPS map as well, so you can also spot the color for the low or the high pressure on the track.
Easy. Perfect. So a great, we've talked about that a lot here where different users have different ways of learning styles, right? Being sometimes the graphs work well, sometimes it's the channels report with numbers, sometimes it's visual in that GPS map. So perfect. With all that said, then let's jump up to, we just did the oil pressure analysis, right? Let's just walk down through driver shifting analysis. This one here, I thought was pretty cool. You've added in a You've done a number of different things here that that I thought were kind of interesting, and I thought that I wanted to show this one. Give us a quick explanation of what we're seeing here.
On the track map, you see gears plotted on the map.
Mm-hmm. So you've got your gear ECU from the gear control unit. Okay, yes. Perfect.
And you see the money channel again in the top, speed and RPM, of course. The second row are the steering wheel inputs of the shifting pedals. So I can see tip up and tip down for the shifting.
Paddle shifters, yep. Yes. Perfect.
We have some lag in the system, so sometimes you see a downshift before the tip channel, but that's a thing of the car.
Okay.
Then you see on level 3 in green, you see the actual gear of the car. And we had a webinar with Samir from yourdatadriven.com, and he had explained to us that you can make an ideal gear channel depending on your power band of your car with a complex Excel that he has made. And I've tried it, and you see the results here. So depending on your RPM and your power band of your car, the MAF channel will calculate the ideal gear. So I've plotted it over it to see the difference.
Perfect. Again, wrapping together some things you learned from the from a previous webinars. That's pretty cool information. Not exactly perfect all of the time, but it certainly gives you an idea of hey, maybe we got to look into this. Is this you know, it just points you to go look at the RPM and the speed and let's chat to the driver and see if maybe he can try that once or twice.
Exactly. Okay.
And then you've got a driver shift error code down here that's a math channel. What is that showing us?
We have a gearbox control unit that shifts electrical the gears. So it's no hydraulics or pneumatics. It's an electrical actuator. And there's a control unit of it. And when the driver pulls the pedal for the downshift too soon, the control unit will prevent it from downshifting because you will overrev the car. And when that happens, we have there is a bit channel, and it will give a certain value. And I've made a math channel that gives one as an output when that happens.
Gotcha. Very, so very
easy spot downshift errors.
Yeah, and then just another, the car pretty much saves itself, but it if a tire was locked up or something, it would allow it to, if ABS wasn't working perfectly or something, it would allow it to downshift. And then as soon as the ABS came off, it would over rev. And so it's just a great tool to be able to chat with the driver and clean up these little things. Perfect.
Yes.
Okay.
And maybe nice to add, I have a way of working that all my math channels are starting with a capital M. So I can easily spot if a channel is a math channel or a raw channel out of the car.
That is a great point. And I did not notice this when we first started chatting the other day. And this is something that I will probably implement in everything that I do from now on. And one of the things you're adding to me, I just opened up the math channel box. Everybody can see the M's there. And if I go into the normal measures, if you start to scroll through here really quickly, you can start to see, you know, P's and M's, G's for the, you know, for different things, right? Where that information is coming from, it's a pretty good idea.
Because when I make an error in a math channel, I get strange results. And you can spend a lot of time troubleshooting for something you did yourself in a MAF channel. So it's easy to spot, is it a raw channel or is it an own MAF channel?
Yep. Absolutely. And in Ray Studio 2, the our current software, you know, we're not using the beta Ray Studio 3. When we're using this software, we cannot, there is no search bar to go in and find this stuff. So when I brought up that RPM really quickly, my eyes, as I scanned down looking for it, I was just scanning the first letter. And when I came, you know, I just went right past all the math channel stuff in the list. And as soon as I seen some things that didn't have that, I looked with more detail. It actually helped me find the channels better. I'm a big fan of sorting the channels and getting them right where I want them, because it's hard for me to find things with this many channels sometimes. This makes this a little bit easier. I love that idea. Perfect. I seen in the chat box that Kyle says, I would like to see the wheel slip analysis as well. And me too. It was one of my favorites. So I'm going to, it's the next on the list. So I'm going to bring that one up. This is another just wonderful way of setting it up. And chat about a little bit why you use this, what you've found and what you do with this.
It's a little bit difficult to see, but you'll have the front axis, two wheel speeds on top of each other, but the colors are almost the same. Then you have the wheel slip ratio from the front wheels, both.
So this is a result of just a math channel based on these two. So you get the positive and negative slip.
Yes, and it are two channels on top of each other. So front left and front right. And then you have the same for the rear axle.
And you can see the difference right there of the two, basically the same color, but it shows it and then shows it into the next math channel.
And at the bottom, you have the lateral and the longitudinal forces to see if there's cornering or braking. And it's the flex signal of the ABS when it works. And because it's a front wheel driven car, it's lifting up the inside rear wheel a lot, so the ABS is working a lot on this car. That's why I've made it. You can identify better if the ABS was working because of inside wheel lift or because maximum braking force before the corner.
And I love that what you've done here, and you mentioned it to me a couple of times as we were chatting, preparing for this, is we always talk about the what happened, where did it happen, why did it happen, right? And this user profile, I'm going to zoom back out just so it's clear. This user profile is about brakes and wheel slip. And so what you've done is you've given the raw data, you've done the quick math, so you very fast can look at the magnitude of the slip and understand where it happened. And then what I really love is this fifth line down here. It is the first things you would look for the why, right? And you've included those right here in here. So you can look real quickly and see, was it a braking event? Was it a lateral event? And was the ABS active when these things were happening? And did that reduce it when the ABS, you know, started up, or all these different things, right? So I just love that as a screen. It's almost a one-stop place. There's not a whole lot more information you would need for that particular question that's in your mind.
Yes.
Perfect, I love that.
Also used for a deeper look into the data.
Yeah, exactly. You had one here that fairly quick. We'll go through this one. This was you called it fuse box analysis, and that was one that I saw early on, and I thought, well, okay, what is that exactly? So, give me a quick, give me the 1 minute version of why you need to see that.
This car has a PDM, but it's an Volkswagen Audi PDM. Mm-hmm. And it only gives an error code when there is an output that is tripped. So when the maximum load is over a certain value for one of the outputs, it will give a bit identifier. And you have a table from it from the factory locally. So when you look at here, you see at fuse box channel 2 an error, and that I think it's at number 5.
It looks like a value of 5, yeah.
Yeah, it's a value of 5. And when I look in the table, I see that this is an error on the ventilation fan for the driver. So this, I think this is, because it's really short, it's a glitch in the somewhere. But when it's larger, like braking lights or a cooling fan, I can pass the information to the mechanics to check it.
Yeah, perfect. And one of the things that we chatted about a little bit is you tend to run with this test lap's toolbar across the bottom turned off just to get more screen real estate space for your data analysis. But what's kind of interesting is you can look down here, the way he has it set up, where it only has the errors, the flags. So you could actually scan this real quickly and see that that was the only channel where there was one. In here, and the other thing that you have done is you've set up your your snap function to be off. So immediately when you come in here, you can actually just scroll, you know, arrow down to zoom out or scroll, use your scroll wheel. So it's already set up to zoom out and see the entire run. And so you quickly, now you can scan it with a little bit more granularity here and look at it all even better than across the bottom if you don't open that up. So that's kind of a cool tip.
Yes, and additional to that, I have a math channel that gives a one with when one of all these channels give an error code. And that's in my engine report. So I can spot there if there is any issue. And then again, I peel the onion to this user profile to check it.
And
the back,
back half?
I think it's a third from the right.
This one here? Yeah, okay. Okay.
Now two to the left, please. One more, yes.
This one here, fuse box alarm. So you would have seen that here first because you're looking for anything that's not a zero in this particular column. That would have maybe driven you right to this one next, right? Okay. If that was your concern.
Cool.
Very, very cool. Very, very cool. Let's go to driver input analysis. We've got about another 10 minutes or so. This one is a lot of information, but let me just jump over here, turn the measures on so it looks right. Lots of information here, but it's again, it's for, you're going to sit down with the driver maybe, or you're looking at inputs of what the driver does. Give us a quick run through of what you've got this set up like.
This is all the input from the driver to the car. So at top, again, the money channel speed. Then we have our throttle pedal and also the speed of the pedal. So the degrees per second.
So you got throttle and you've created a math channel with the differential of that. So you can see how fast the driver is applying or releasing the throttle pedal.
Yes.
Perfect. And the two different colors. Good.
Yes. And I have the same for braking, but this is the total brake force. So this is a car with two master cylinders. So I calculate the total brake force because when you want to check it between laps and sessions and the brake balance has changed, your front brake pressure value doesn't match with the other session. So I've created a total brake pressure channel.
I think that's a great idea. I have not, that is one that I will implement in the stuff that I do. I've typically not done that because I'm just looking for the shape as much, but I think it's more correct to use total brake pressure and get, you know, maybe you've changed pads or something. This is a much more accurate way of looking at it.
It's not my idea. It's from Jorge's book.
Yeah, exactly.
It works fine. And it also gives you the brake pedal speed again, just like the throttle. So you can check on smoothness and aggressiveness from the driver to the pedal. Then you have the gearbox signal, and there's also the clutch pressure in it.
You can barely see it down there.
Sequential gearbox, so you don't use the clutch here. Then we have steering wheel input in purple. In green, you have the speed steer. So the speed of change of a direction from the steering wheel. And I have a math channel made when there's one of the steering wheel buttons is pushed. It's just to check if the driver had used something like lights or wipers, but also it can help with the why did it happen when the driver makes a mistake because he was on the radio button. We can discuss that.
And then you have that lap marker across the bottom, which I think is just intriguing. So now you've got another place where you can find what happened and what the driver was doing around that same time frame.
Exactly. Because I think most of the time we will use it for driver input things, oversteer, understeer, that kind of stuff. So I have to put it in here as well.
Good, very good. I love that profile personally. That was the driver input and then the driver driver line analysis. This one here is also just, again, more of some of the same kind of information, or at least presented in the same way, but you've got it in different ways because you're trying to find, you focus on a little bit of a different area here.
Yes, so we have, again, speed. The throttle signal and the brake pressure, the total, again, just as reference, you have the steering angle and the lateral acceleration. So have any idea what you're doing. Then we have the curvature channel, so it's the inverse corner radius. I can get my head around the normal corner radius. I get my head can work with it, so curvature is better for me. So you can better see where the apex maybe lies in the corner. And then channel, what I really like is the understeer angle of the car. It's quite complex to build. We had a nice webinar about it from Jorge Severs, and it gives you the more or less the understeer angle of the car.
And here's
a point on the track.
And here's a good example of what you might. I'm going to back out here.
Yep.
Get the cursor a little bit out of the way. The steering angle versus lateral G is just a very quick, but yet surprisingly accurate way of looking at the data and figuring out these especially oversteer moments. Is when you have this set up, if you're turning the steering wheel and it's creating G's in the same direction, right? And then all of a sudden you got this big spike going the other way with the steering. It is just very, very pronounced showing you that there's an oversteer moment, right? Yes. And so if we zoom in on this particular one just a little bit closer, you now got the curvature, the radius that the car is going around. In this case, it's inverse. But and here you can see the oversteer come down, and then boom, change to maybe even a little bit of an understeer, and then coming back to almost neutral, right? And heading back towards neutral. But you can see this oversteer moment, and you can see that it's right at the end of the braking zone, right at near the apex. And it begin to happen. If I put my cursor here as it starts, you can see it's not throttle induced even. I mean, it's when he's totally off the brakes, totally off the throttle, and it begins to come around. A kind of an interesting effect, and it gives the mechanics and the engineers an idea of what to go and change on the car. It's not driver induced as much, maybe, or maybe it was a curb, maybe put the Z axis in there too, but kind of interesting ways of looking at the data and then be able to come up with an idea of what to go work on.
Yes.
Okay. And then, and that's the driver line analysis. And we've got a limited slip diff analysis, which you've put together a couple of things that we have chatted about in the past and put them together into this one graph.
I've had some help from Matt. He's in the chat box. We've discussed it because I think we have an issue in our differential. It's a clutch style diff. And what you see in the measures graph is again speed. I've created a math channel that gives differential in front wheel speed, so left and right divided as an absolute value. Now the inputs for the locking of the differential are of course throttle and brake, so you see them there. And final, you see steering wheel angle to give an idea of where in the corner the car is. On the bottom left, you have the front wheel speed differential plotted on the map. And on the top left, that's the complex one. It gives at the bottom your speed differential from the front wheels. And on the left, you have the Newton meters output of the engine measured at the gearbox, after the gearbox. So this car gives out of the ECU the torque of the engine. And I've made a math channel that's incorporated the gearing ratios of the gearbox and the final drive to calculate my torque output at the wheels or at the differential. So you can see the gearbox isn't quite locking as nice as you suppose, but it's on the braking quite open. So you see a lot of spread in your wheel speed difference. That's nice to have.
But this, not so nice to have.
Exactly. You see more or less three or four clouds in it. The top one is second gear, third gear, fourth and fifth gear. And especially at second gear, we have a lot of spread.
Yeah.
And it's a thing that we shouldn't have, I guess. I have to work with it more, but I'm afraid we have a preload issue in this case.
And the differential, and the reason that you use the torque output versus the wheel speed differences is the more torque output, the more that the diff should be locking, right? Up, ramp up and lock down. So when it's at high torque output, this graph really should almost be a hockey stick, right? In a perfect world, as far as you know yet, yeah. You're still working on it and trying to understand it. So
I've tested in on our other car, on a rear-wheel drive car, and it's like a hockey stick.
That's gotcha. True. Gotcha.
So, but I want to use it in the future to check my preload. When you see things shifts over sessions, you can point out to the mechanic from maybe we have an issue.
Yeah, whether we had an issue last time or not, we have a change now. So something is happening, yeah. Right?
And you can also plot it again, gearbox oil temp.
Ah, there you go.
So you can check if there's something with the clutches or... I think the XY plots are really powerful to play around with and see what you can find.
The more I have gotten into data and started to do more data analysis, the more I use XY plots. I think it's just part of the learning curve, and you can see bigger picture stuff. It's very valuable.
Yep.
And the other one that I would consider doing is I would bring this up, and you look at lap, you know, look at it when it's cold and look at it when it gets really warm, right? So you're kind of doing that temperature thing, but doing it by pulling and looking at different laps across the entire run. Another way of looking at stuff really quickly.
Yep.
Perfect. Cool. And we just got just another minute or two. We'll look at this last one, and then we'll kind of tidy it up. This one is what you're calling a driver coast analysis. You know, we've talked a lot about that here in our webinars. And what have you built here?
It's the first thing I learned here.
There you go.
So I've made channels for when the driver is on throttle based on G-force, the same for brake, the same for corners, and I've made a channel wide open throttle that's based on the pedal above, I think, 96% throttle. I get a wide open throttle signal, so I can see the difference between the driver full on throttle and not full.
Right here.
Yes.
Brake on.
The brake on, and we have two different coast channels. The normal coast on is when the driver has no throttle, no brake, and no corner input. Mm-hmm. And the coast pedal, brake, throttle is when the driver don't push one of the two pedals.
And you've done it in a way here that you can look at a certain lap, obviously, by us turning on the test laps toolbar across the bottom. We can see, you know, played different laps. But you've also done it with a channels report as part of it, which allows you to quickly look at this and maybe judge which lap you want to go look at real quickly too, which I like.
Exactly. And when you look at it, you can see the most quick lap times are with the lesser brake lap time, for example.
Yeah, yep, there you go, right there. And, but not quite the longest wide open throttle in seconds, right? So the 93 was slightly more. So it motorsports is never easy, right? It's not just holding it to the floor, right?
Yep. So that's a nice channel to chat with drivers about.
Yeah.
You see on the GPS map also coast on, so you can spot easily the places where the driver is coasting.
Yep. Boom, 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 boom. And then, I've chatted with a lot of driver coaches as part of this and other things that I've done. And this wide open throttle number, a lot of people see that as a driver comfort channel, right? So you've made some good adjustments to the car and that number jumps up 2 or 3%. The driver is typically more comfortable and is able to get to full throttle earlier. It's just another good measure of driver comfort, car handling and driver comfort.
Yeah, cool.
Perfect. Perfect. Before we jump out of here, is there anything we've just quickly, because we only have an hour, we went through these basic user profiles. We're sharing some of these more powerful ones that you've created. it's a subset of what you generally use in your day-to-day stuff. You typically will have another, you know, 20 or 30 of them as you're building them and adjusting them and moving them around. And I even noticed that you do Jorge talks about and some others where you have just a kind of a scratch one, right? Where I just open that one up and do some things in it, right? And just try some things out. But this is just a subset, but it's the most powerful things that we wanted to present today.
Cool.
Perfect. Perfect. The again, just as we kind of close this out, this data file is available for everybody, whether you're watching this live, the links have been in the chat box. If you're watching this in YouTube later, go down to the description box, you'll have the data file, this data file from Zolder and this Audi. You'll have the profiles that we have all set up where you can import these where they end up showing up here. The math files, math channel files, and the track map, where you can grab this. Now, let me make sure I close this up with one last thing. When you go to import your user profiles, make sure you save your older user profiles. Go to file before you import the ones that Tice has been nice enough to loan to us here. Make sure you export your current user profiles. If you don't, it's one or the other, right? So export yours. I suggest you do that once a month or so as you adjust yours anyway and keep those as backups. And then you'll come in and do the import user files and you'll import the ones that Tice has created here for us. So make sure you do that. Same thing on the math channels. When you come to import his math channel set, I would do it inside of his the tab that is of the test. If you do it inside of the general tab, you're going to overwrite your general list. So make sure you do the importation of the math channel file here using import set inside of the sample, the test that he has provided, or else you may overwrite some of your math channels. A great idea is to always come in some month or so and just do an export of your set that you have to always have backups. So, okay, just a couple of tips on working with those things. Let's jump back out now and let's jump back out to the presentation materials here. Tice has been fantastic to help us come in and talk about these things. We went out into the Liveray Studio data analysis portion, learned a lot of cool things, a lot of neat ways of looking at that. Learned a lot of stuff that he has learned from our webinars. So it's been pretty fun. I've got that in the wrong mode, don't I? Now that I look at it, all of our videos. When we do these live webinars, they go up onto YouTube just as fast as we can do it. Usually within an hour or so, these will be available. I know we do them here during the day, during the middle of the day here in North America. Tice has been pretty handy for him. It comes right after dinner time. I think we start at 7 p.m. in the Netherlands. So it's after his work day and he's able to come home and sit down and watch these. I know here in the States, it's a little harder for people to watch live. That's why we work so hard to making sure they're available in YouTube with all of the same links and all the same information. So go check them out there. This is our 161st video that we've got up there, not only the webinars, not only the 96 webinars we've done, but a lot of other videos as well. Check out all the different stuff that we have there. There's a lot of value there for you. The customer support, we're in the heat of the summer now, right? And we're out there going to racetracks and having a good time looking forward to giving all the customer support we can. Look for us either in the vans or our guys walking around with backpacks and we're out there to help you. And if you can't find us at the tracks, give us a call at the 800 number and make sure that we can help you get the most out of your data, your AIM data logger investment. So we're out there to help you. Next webinar. The next webinar we're going to step back and it's number four of our fourth. I expected that we were going to have four driver coaches come in and do work with us a little bit on our driver coaching series. And the next one we're going to have is Sabra Cook. And Sabra is I've known the family for a long time and known her from when she was in karting, and she's worked her way up. She's just such an impressive person with all that she does, engineering background, and has worked in Formula One at for a team for a year, racing karting and up. I've seen her in MX5 Cup this year. She worked in the W series where all women drivers in that series. She's gone to those, been a podium finisher there. And she coaches a lot of young drivers around, especially in karting, other things too, but especially in karting. So she's going to join us next week, and we're going to talk about a little bit about her background and some of the stuff that she has learned from data and video, and then talk about some of the different ways that she uses data to help coach. And I think it'll be a pretty good, pretty cool webinar and chat about that. And then we've got some really good additional webinar guests coming up that we'll announce as we get a little bit closer. Really looking forward to Sabra being here. It's going to be a good time chatting with her. So I'd like to thank Tice. This is not Tice's business. This is a profession and a hobby and a fun thing for Tice to do and for him to come on and do this. If you want to get a hold of Tice, go ahead and just give me a note. And we don't want to overwhelm him. It's not his task to do a lot of these things, but he certainly is happy to answer maybe a question or two. If you have anything, make sure you drop me a note and I'll put you in touch with Tice and we'll get you some additional information about this data if there's some questions that you have. So Tice, thank you very much for coming and joining us. I know I kept you a couple minutes longer, but you were doing such a good job talking about those user profiles that I wanted to continue on and finish them all. So thanks for coming. Is there anything else you'd like to kind of add as we kind of close this one up?
No, thank you for having me. And I really hope my accent was too bad for everybody. But well, it's not my my native language, so that's kind of a struggle, but I think it worked out for everybody. So
no problem. No problem whatsoever. We enjoy having you here with us. The accent was not a problem at all. It's always one of those things where maybe it takes about a minute or two, but if you listen for just a little bit, we get into your groove of the way that you speak, and I understood every word. So perfect. Again, I thank you for coming. I know it's a lot of extra work to get ready for these, and it's not exactly what you like to do as far as publicly speaking. But you did a great job. I hope maybe we'll even invite you back in the future and have you go to a little deeper into some of the other ones. But either way, we look forward to seeing you here live on our webinars starting next week in the chat box, giving good jabs to everybody about their cars and their speeds and taking a few for yourself as well. The chat box is always so much fun here for those of you that come here live. So
yes, it is, and it was a pleasure to be here, and we will speak again, Roger.
Perfect. I thank you again. I thank everybody for coming. Thank you for all watching on YouTube, and we'll see you everybody here on June 8th on next Tuesday for our next webinar. Talk to you guys soon.